Hello, my name is Leah Davis, and I'm an associate professor of medicine at Vanderbilt University Medical Center. My lab studies the genetic architecture and epidemiology of complex human traits, mostly neuropsychiatric conditions, which means that we think a lot about polygenicity. So a few years ago, on the 100th anniversary of the publication of Ronald Fisher's paper called The Correlation Between Relatives on the Supposition of Mendelian Inheritance, I realized that I actually knew very little about Fisher and about how this paper developed. So I set out to research the story behind the paper and spent a lot of time deep in archives. And what I'm going to share with you today is the result of that research. So in order to understand the impact of this paper, you have to understand that there was a pretty bitter argument raging in the field at the time. And this was, as most bitter arguments usually are, as much about the personalities involved as it was about the science. So to set the stage, we have to go back before Fisher was even born and recall that Charles Darwin's book on the Origin of Species had been published in 1859. And it introduced the ideas of evolution and natural selection to the scientific community. Now, these ideas gripped Darwin and his half-cousin, Francis Galton, of whom you may also have heard. So Francis was 38 at the time. His father had recently died, and he had dropped out of medical school and had suffered a pretty deep depression. And being now independently wealthy and relatively directionless, he went exploring in South Africa and returned home to publish a book called The Narrative of an Explorer in Tropical South Africa. Now, I have not read it, but according to the Royal Geographic Society, it was written in, quote, excellent manly style with much shrewd sense and humor. So he was already developing an interest in variation that he observed between people across the world. And after the publication of his cousin's book, Galton became fascinated with human heredity and developing statistical methods to understand variation in and across populations. He developed the concepts of distributions, bivariate distributions, correlation, regression, and other statistical ideas. So now enter the two most important players in this drama. In the late 1870s, William Bateson and Raphael Weldon met as undergrads studying zoology at Cambridge, and they became close friends. Weldon was a little bit older than Bateson and was one of Bateson's junior teachers. He encouraged Bateson in his studies of marine biology, and they talked at length about Darwin's new evolutionary theories. That evolution occurred was obvious to them, but how did it occur? This was the central question that piqued their curiosity. And Francis Galton was asking the same questions and developing the field of statistics in his search for answers. So in 1889, Galton published the book Natural Inheritance, in which he showed that the frequency distributions of the average size of certain organs in man, plants, and moths were normal. In this book, Galton predicted that selection would not change the shape of the normal distribution, only the mean value. And furthermore, Galton laid out two possibilities for speciation: gradual selection or saltation, also known as abrupt evolutionary change. Weldon began to investigate gradual selection, and Bateson became fascinated with the potential for mutation to drive evolutionary change. Now, about a year later, Weldon published a statistical analysis of data on shrimp that confirmed Galton's prediction about normal distributions. And after that paper was published, Pearson, who was also at University College London, saw the opportunity for a collaboration and began to work with Weldon. Weldon introduced Pearson to Galton, who became a mentor and somewhat of an idol to Pearson. And it was Weldon's data on crabs and his questions about the continuous characteristics of crab populations that provided Pearson the means and the motivation to develop the statistical methods that he became famous for. And by 1893, Weldon and Pearson were publishing papers together describing asymmetrical distributions and introducing the concepts of standard deviations, covariance, and coefficients of variation. Meanwhile, Bateson and his group in Cambridge was focusing on what they described as dimorphic or discrete traits. In his widely read book, Materials for the Study of Variation, in 1894, Bateson argued the case for the importance of discontinuous variations or mutations of large effect in evolutionary change. Weldon, however, was unimpressed by Bateson's argument and his data. He responded that, quote, "The questions raised by the Darwinian hypothesis are purely statistical, and the statistical method is the only one at present obvious by which that hypothesis can be experimentally checked." He was asked to write a critique of Bateson's book for Nature, and while it was overall a positive review, he did take issue with Bateson's thesis of evolution by mutation. And Bateson was incensed. He responded by criticizing Weldon's crab work in a series of letters to Galton. A year later, the situation grew worse when another young investigator published a paper in Nature, again suggesting a model of slow but continuous selection. This drew severe criticism from Bateson, and a series of letters and responses published in Nature ensued. Eventually, Weldon also weighed in, siding with the young investigator, and Bateson was furious. In 1895, Weldon wrote to Bateson saying, "Dear Bateson, I can do no more. First, you accuse me of attacking your personal character, and when I disclaim this, you charge me with a dishonest defense of someone else. If you insist upon regarding any opposition to your opinions concerning such matters as a personal attack upon yourself, I may regret your attitude, but I can do nothing to change it." The friendship had officially soured, and the two sides of this debate had become more entrenched than ever. Bateson and experimentalists Edith Saunders and Reginald Punnett continued to selectively breed plants in the Cambridge Botanical Gardens and publish observations of discontinuous traits, while Weldon and his wife Florence continued to gather large amounts of data from wild populations of crabs and to collaborate with Pearson in London to develop ways to analyze it. The next plot point in the story occurred at the turn of the century. Hugo De Vries, a botanist from Austria, who was also aware of Gregor Mendel's work, attended the 1899 conference of the Royal Horticultural Society. There, he heard a lecture by Bateson describing the work that he and Edith Saunders were doing with sweet pea plants in Cambridge. And realizing the similarity to Mendel's pea plants, he published a paper in 1900 referring to the work of Mendel in a footnote. Mendel's laws were rediscovered, giving Bateson the additional evidence that he needed. He became a huge supporter of the, quote, Mendelian theory and wrote to Galton to alert him to the manuscript, saying, "In case you may miss it, Mendel's work seems to me the most remarkable investigation yet made on heredity, and it is extraordinary that it should have got forgotten." Meanwhile, Pearson and Weldon were skeptical of Mendel's ratios, believing that the results were too good to be true. Weldon noted that in the wild, peas typically varied much more continuously from yellow to green, and Mendel had done extensive inbreeding to obtain the pure green and yellow lines. To Weldon, this implied that Mendel's results were an artifact of having removed all continuous variations between green and yellow seed color before starting his hybridization experiments. Weldon wrote to Pearson voicing concern over what he saw as a lack of rigor in the field, saying, quote, "The contention that numbers mean nothing and do not exist in nature is a very serious thing, which will have to be fought. Most other people have got beyond it, but most biologists have not. Do you think it would be too hopelessly expensive to start a journal of some kind?" And so the year 1902 really witnessed the formalization of the two camps. The Mendelians, Bateson, Saunders, and Punnett in Cambridge, where Bateson published his own translation of Mendel's work, and the biometricians, Weldon and Pearson in London, where they founded the journal Biometrica. And by 1904, about 15 years after the argument began, things came to a head again, this time at the meeting of the zoological section for the British Association for the Advancement of Science. And by this point, the editor of Nature had refused to publish any further correspondence between Weldon and Bateson on this issue. Everyone in the field was aware of the debate and the bitterness that had developed between these two old friends. The meeting was being held in Cambridge, the turf of the Mendelians, and Bateson was the president of the zoological section. He used his presidential address to discuss his position on Mendelianism, saying, quote, "For if anyone will stoop to examine nature in those humble places, he will not wait long before he learns the truth about variation. It is impossible to suppose that these striking differences are the product of continued selection, or indeed that they represent the results of gradual transformation of any kind," end quote. An argument broke out between Weldon and Bateson right there and then during the session, leaving the conference goers shifting pretty uncomfortably in their seats. The event was so explosive that 2 years later, when Weldon died suddenly of pneumonia, the New York Times wrote about it in his obituary, describing the scene and saying that, quote, "The debate, which was conducted before a large and somewhat agitated audience, resolved itself into a dialectical duel between the president of the section and Professor Weldon, and developed quite a considerable amount of heat." Weldon's death in 1906 was even considered by many to be connected to this argument, as he had become somewhat obsessed with disproving the Mendelian hypothesis in each subsequent paper that proposed it. He worked frantically and excessively, saying, quote, "I cannot leave this thing unsettled," and causing his good friend Pearson to voice concern. Eventually, Pearson persuaded Weldon and Florence to take a holiday with him and his wife over the Easter break. Weldon caught a chest cold and died a few weeks later. Pearson and many others who knew Weldon generally agreed that this was from the exhaustion, worry, and overwork. Of his friend, Pearson said, quote, "He was by nature a poet, and these give the best science, for they give ideas." Weldon was 45 years old. The bitterness of the debate gave way to a quieter resentment between Pearson and Bateson that seethed for another decade. Now, enter 26-year-old Ronald Fisher. By this point, the divide in the field was older than Fisher himself, and it had profoundly shaped genetics and evolutionary biology. Fisher was in an ideal position to bridge the divide. He had been trained as a mathematician, but was working in Cambridge, the home of the Mendelian experimentalists. He was not locked into a set of beliefs, but was open to considering the possibility of another solution. And in 1916, his paper was communicated to the Royal Society with the mathematical proofs demonstrating that, in general, the hypothesis of cumulative Mendelian factors seems to fit the facts very accurately. This was the first formal reconciliation between Mendelian genetics and biometry. It was a description of polygenic traits. Reginald Punnett and Carl Pearson were invited to review it. The paper was heavy on math, and from Punnett's perspective, too theoretical, as he commented that it dealt with weightless elephants upon frictionless surfaces, where at the same time, we are largely ignorant of the other properties of the said elephants and surfaces. Pearson's review was similarly dismissive, although while the paper was not rejected, it was withdrawn. It was published 2 years later in 1918 in the Transactions of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. And this paper continues to be cited today as one of the most influential papers in human genetics. So in reading and piecing together the history and the impact of this paper, I'm really struck by the deep commitment on both sides of the debate that I believe began with a genuine desire to know the truth, but along the way was shaped by pride, shame, and a feeling of betrayal that in the end really thwarted a deeper understanding of the truth and lasted for decades. And to me, the lesson here is clear. In a scientific debate, we must be on the same side, simply put, on the side of truth. If we start off or end up on our own sides, we've already contaminated the nobility of the science with our own self-interests, and we are doomed to failure by dogma. But this is not enough. Science also needs morality. Otherwise, misguided belief systems that spring up from the hegemonic social structures in which we're embedded can also blind us to the truth. And there was one thing that the Mendelians and the biometricians agreed on, and that was eugenics. So recall that in the beginning of our story, the United States was fighting a war over slavery and enacting racist legislation to prohibit immigration from Asia and Africa to the United States. Galton, who introduced these ideas to our friends, Weldon, Bateson, and Pearson, went on to concern himself more with what he believed was the genetic superiority of the upper classes, encouraging men like Charles Davenport and Henry Laughlin, who began the Eugenics Record Office in 1910 at Cold Spring Harbor, with the support of American academia and industry, including philanthropy from the Rockefeller and Kellogg families. The organized efforts of the eugenicists, combined with Mendelian determinism, had massive impacts on popular opinion, on federal immigration policy, and on state policies, including legislation such as the Virginia Racial Integrity Act of 1924, which made interracial marriage illegal, and another 1924 act in Virginia that legalized the involuntary sterilization of the, quote, feeble-minded. In 1927, the Supreme Court heard arguments in the case of Carrie Buck versus the state of Virginia, which ostensibly challenged that statute. The court sided with the state, and Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, who's widely regarded as one of the greatest legal minds of all time, wrote the decision. He famously stated that, quote, three generations of imbeciles is enough, and the law was to remain on the books in many states until the late 1980s. It's important to note that not all geneticists were eugenicists. Thomas Hunt Morgan, Herbert Spencer Jennings, J.B.S. Haldane, they were all among vocal anti-eugenicists. Chesterton, a writer and philosopher, famously stated, quote, every tramp who is sulk, every laborer who is shy, every rustic who is eccentric, can quite easily be brought under such conditions as were designed for homicidal maniacs. That is the situation, and that is the point. We are already under the eugenicist state, and nothing remains to us but rebellion. So it may sound sentimental, but I mean this very genuinely. As we reflect on 100 years of polygenicity, of the development of human genetics as a field, and as we consider the biological and societal questions and problems of our day, and debate the merits of the evidence that we are presented with, it's my sincere hope that we can always be mindful of our shared history, and that we can be guided by compassion and humility in our search for the truth. Thank you for your attention.